Can you kind of give us a brief history of Kapurin?
Oh.
I heard that it was one of the first towns that was founded here.
Okay. Yeah, the first town, obviously, was San Luis, the oldest town. And then soon after, or almost at the same time, was the town of Guadalupe down by Conejos in 1851, 1852, that era. So then, as people settled that land grant, the Conejos land grant, like I said, was all the way from San Antonio all the way to La Garita. And so people started saying, well, who's going to go where to use the land, so that we're not all trying to use the same place. So people kind of started spreading out. And so on my side of the family, the Valdeses and the Martinez and the Rivales were some of those early families that came north from Conejos, or from Guadalupe and Conejos, and established the town of Kapurin. And that, the original town of Kapurin, was built in 1858. And so this little community was built near an orchard, wild orchard of Kapurin trees. So they named the town Kapurin. It was built right along the, just north of the Lajara Creek, between the Lajara and the Alamosa Creeks. They're pretty close to each other. And it was, the original town of Kapurin was about a mile and a half east of where Kapurin is at now. And in the one spring, I believe it was 1865, in the spring someone lit a fire. Of course, you build fires to cook and all that kind of stuff. And when the wind blows, you know how strong the wind can get, the whole village caught fire and burned down, including the orchard and everything of the Kapurin trees. So they decided, well, first of all, we built the town in the wrong place, because we built the town on the floodplain, and the floodplain is better for crops, not for houses. So let's build the town where it's not good for crops, but we can still build buildings on it and leave the bottom lands for crops. So they moved west about a mile and a half, where the closest part where the two rivers come together is only about a mile or less than a mile from each other. And that's where they built the town of Kapurin, and then the croplands or the bottom lands were used for crops. So that in many history books, the town is recorded as having been built in 1868, 10 years later, because that's where the current Kapurin, okay? And so there were a lot of other villages that surrounded Kapurin. Kapurin was kind of like today's Alamosa. Alamosa is the central hub of all these communities, right? Well, Kapurin was central hub of all these other communities around it. There was, that I can think of, was La Huita and La Joya and Condado, Alamoso, Gomez. So all these little different communities. And there were 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 schools. Okay, that's where the original Kapurin school district came in. And of course, each little town had their own chapel. There used to be 2 moradas of the penitentes, one in La Joya and one in Alamoso. And the people were all farmers and ranchers, because it was the land grant, so they had all that mountain, and they had tons of animals, that like the Valdeses, that my mother's side of the family, like my great uncle had 3,000 head of sheep. My grandfather was not a sheep man, he was a cowboy. That's where the similar conflict came in, between the sheep and the cattle. So the town of Kapurin, back to the question, grew and had included a rodeo grounds, there was a sawmill, there was a big dance hall, and all these different things. And then when the land was lost, the source of income is lost, because you can't have 3,000 head of sheep on 200 acres of land. You need a lot of land, that kind of stuff. So people had to sell off what they had And it, what they were left with wasn't enough to live on, so they had to hire out as laborers. So the people that were raising sheep and had the big sheep farms now are working for somebody else, being sheep herders or moving to Wyoming. And so the town, having lost its base and the losing the water, the farms simply dried up. What used to be huge farmlands, if you go to Capulín now, it's all llano, it's all chamizo. You can still see the ditches where they were at one time, but no water. What happened with the water is that, like I said, the government came in and built a terrace reservoir, floated a loan, and then years later, when that loan came due, it was the bankers in Monte Vista that bought that loan, built a big canal from the river to Monte Vista and diverted the water, and the people down in Capulín were like, where's our water? No, it's going that way. And so can't raise crops, your land goes dry, people move to Denver to go work in factories or work somewhere else, doing something else. So the people leave, the town dwindles, and poverty sets in.
Okay, so we were just wondering about your family connections here in Capulín.
Okay, on my mother's side has the probably the longest and more historic side is the Valdez and Martinez families. My mother's maiden name was Valdez. The Valdezes, some of the founders of the town of Capulín, were Valdezes, and that's where my family descends from. They were one of the 40 families that were grantees of the Cornelis land grant. So at one point, the Valdez family owned almost property like from La Jara up to Capulín and up into the mountains. It was a huge tract of land that they had. And my the other side, the Martinez family, were also grantees families, but many of them migrated like to Pagosa Springs. So there's a large contingency of Martinezes in Pagosa Springs, as well as some Martinezes here, like you probably know Red Martinez. That family is part of our Martinez side of the family. On my dad's side, there's Arribales, which is also a one of the 40 families receiving the land grant. That was on my dad's maiden mother's side. And on my Lopez side, that's where I still need to do some more research, because I believe that the family, Lopez family, came originally from San Luis to Capulín and settled here. So that those are the four sides of my family. On my dad's side, Rival Lopez, and on my mother's side, Martinez Valdez.
So what are some of the significant buildings that used to exist here that aren't in use or don't exist anymore?
Okay, maybe I should start a little further back. Okay, so this used to be the Gallegos grocery store here.
No, why don't you rotate your camera for images?
So the Gallegos grocery store, and it was right next to the Maloff grocery store here.
And then this becomes the Martinez Market at some point?
It became Martinez Market, and now it's owned, both are owned by Richard Quintana. On this other side, there used to be a Fragua, a blacksmith shop, and then was the Gonzalez mechanics shop here. Where this building is at here, this open space between here and that building, was the Ortiz grocery store, a large two-story building that burned down in the 30s. The family claims that it was the first movie theater in the San Luis Valley, was at the Ortiz grocery store on the second floor.
What year would that have been?
For the movie theater?
Yeah.
In the 30s. 20s and 30s, because the store burned down, I believe, like in the late 30s. This building here, that's a long building, belonged to the Catholic Church. But when I was a child, it was kind of like the community center. There was a boxing ring and there was training center. Kids used to come in and be engaged in activities in this building. It was very active at the time. The first fire department was here. It's made out of adobe. My father built that building. And then later, when they added more vehicles, they built this additional building to the fire department. This used to be a kind of like a boarding house. At one point, the bottom floor was also a gambling hall. People would come and play pool, and they had gambling tables, that kind of stuff. And people would stay at rent rooms and stay there.
Did you ever lose any money there?
That was before my time. The Catholic Church, built in 1912, was built with stone that was brought in from Hot Creek, which is about 9 miles west of here. So it's local stone. And the original, the first church building here in Capulin was an adobe structure, and I've got a picture in the Jubilee booklet that we put together. And the original church was at this corner here. And then originally was built in a square, flat roof, and then because the population was growing and the congregation was growing, the church was expanded and they added what are called cruceros on the sides, and they made it a pitched roof church. Back in the late 1880s. So this was the first cemetery in the town of Capulin, right next to the church, of course, because the cemeteries originally were right next to the church, sacred ground. There's even one headstone from a soldier who fought in the Civil War veteran. So the people here, even though it was 1860s, that's when the town originally was settled in 1858, but it was like 4 miles down the road. But that original town was made out of jacales, and jacales are upright poles with batting in between. In the spring, and they built it on bottom ground by the river, and in the spring the river would flood, and of course it was not a very ideal location to have the town. And then in the spring, when the winds come up, somehow someone was burning something and the whole town caught on fire. Being out of wood, the town burned down, and so the people decided to build here, which is further up the river, higher ground, and decided to make adobe structures that wouldn't burn like the jacal would. One interesting fact about jacales is that people would go out and gather the leaves of, I forget the bulrushes.
The jaras?
Not the jaras. Pussy willows. What's another name for pussy willows? Anyway.
Cattails?
Cattails. And because the surface of the cattail leaf is very like waxy, they would weave those into mats, and then they would put those as the roof on top of the jacales. So that when it rained, the water would drain off, run off the slick surface of the leaves.
So is this the side of the church where the father used to live?
So the church was built originally, and then the rectory was the one on the north side. And there's a chapel, so there's a church, there's a chapel, and then the rectory. Then when the nuns were brought in to teach, because, and I'll talk a little bit about the school, when the nuns were brought in to teach, They added the convent. So this used to be the nuns' convent. Benedictine nuns that were here.
And you're talking about these original settlers. What did they do? What did they dedicate their days to?
Most of them raised sheep. A few were a little more bold and raised cattle. Because back then there was this cattle and sheep range wars. So even within families, within my own family, the Valdeses, some chose to raise cattle and the majority of them raised sheep. And so there was this kind of struggle back and forth about rangeland.
Can you talk a little bit about that and, you know, what that struggle meant on the frontier where Anglos were coming in with more cattle and trying to fence off? And
right. The concept of the land grant, original land grant, was it's communal. No one person owns the land, no one person owns the water. You share everything. Everything was shared. And even taking animals up to the mountains for grazing, they would designate areas, but then that wasn't necessarily going to be yours permanently. They would rotate. Because one thing about sheep is that when they eat grass, they pull it out by the roots. And so that destroys the habitat, while cattle chop the grass off and they leave the roots so things regenerate. So that was the kind of battle. And then when the Anglos came in, most of them were cattle ranchers, and there was a competition for land. And with the Anglos, they brought in the concept of private land ownership, and along with it, water ownership, and started getting land and using barbed wire to fence off their property. And so among the Hispanic people, the expression is, con el alambre vino el hambre. When the barbed wire came, hunger came, because people couldn't maintain large herds of animals because now the property lines were drawn and it was more restricted, and so you could raise less. You could only raise less amounts of livestock. And with less livestock, it was less profit, and so the concept of going hungry because you don't have the kind of income that you would have with the larger herds. Going back to the in history known as the range wars between cattle and sheep herders, ranchers.
And what happened, how did it change Capulín and these local residents who were, you know, both ranchers and farmers when the land grants started being, well, not recognized as much?
Right. What happened was the Conejos land grant was about 2.5 million acres, meaning from the Continental Divide to the Rio Grande, and from the San Antonio Mountain all the way to La Garita Peaks. So, I mean, it's like half of the valley was the Conejos land grant. And the early 1900s, the U.S. government came in and nationalized a large part of that land grant and turned it into what's known as the Rio Grande National Forest, which is still in existence today. And then later on, the BLM came and nationalized even more land. And so what was left is what people then had to prove ownership. And the reason that the land grant people lost the land is that when this territory became U.S. territory in 1848 after the Mexican-American War and the Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo, people had to prove ownership. And so the land grant papers that proved ownership of the Conejos land grant were taken to Taos, to the courthouse there, and somehow the papers were lost. And so there goes the proof of ownership. And so then people could come in and simply become squatters and claim land and go to the courthouse, file papers, and get ownership of the land. What the people here complained about was they had been Spanish speakers. There were no schools to teach them English. So when the laws came in and everything was in English, they didn't know about that they had to have deeds to property. They didn't know that they how to read the laws, how to do, go about applying for ownership and all that kind of stuff. And so while they kind of hesitated in knowing what to do, the Anglo settlers coming west knew what to do, went and applied for land and got land that originally belonged to the settlers. So little by little, land was lost that way. Other ways that land was lost was Anglo-Americans would come in and do all kinds of different tricks to take the land away from the people. Things like coming in and saying, well, I sell insurance. And if you want to insure your property from damage and all that kind of stuff, you can buy this insurance. All you have to do is sign this sheet. And little did they realize that the paper that they were signed that was all written in English were deeds to property. Other ways would be gambling. I mentioned gambling hall. Come in and gamble, and the local people losing, and then the guy saying, well, here's an IOU. Just sign it that you're going to pay me, and then once you get the money, you can pay me. But for now, just sign this IOU. If the people would sign, or put an X, because many times didn't know how to write, would put an X, and lo and behold, it was a deed. And they got papers from the courthouse saying, you signed your deed away, or your land away through this deed. Now you have to move. Okay, so that was how land was lost through after the Guadalupe Hidalgo Treaty. Another way that the towns went into depressive states was at the time that the WPA, Works Projects Administration, federal program was giving money to areas to do projects. And one project that was done all over the Western United States was building reservoirs to store water. And so in this area, up above the Alamosa River, the government gave money to build the Terrace Reservoir. And the deal was that local farmers were asked, donate a portion of your water rights for storage purposes. And so the people donated parts of their water rights, told that during times of drought, the water will be stored, and then we can release the water and you'll have water even in dry periods. So the people went along with that. Years went by, 30, 40, 50 years went by. They didn't realize that the money that was given to them to build the Terrace Reservoir was a loan. And somehow the loan was transferred from the government over to the bank in Monte Vista. And when the loan came due, a lot of the farmers in Monte Vista got together, paid off the loan, and now they claimed the water to the reservoir, even though the water had been donated for storage. But they claimed, well, we paid the loan, now we own the reservoir. And if we own the reservoir, we own the water. And so a big canal was built from the river out to Monte Vista, and it's still in existence today. So people here lost water rights, and so without water, what can you do? We could drive around the area and you can see places that are fallowed land, but somewhere you can see where the ditches used to be at one time that were very productive farmlands that now are back to the llano. So those are the two major ways that the towns like Capulin were negatively impacted by the loss of land and by loss of water. And then the third final thing is, with that depression of no economy, kids would go to school, they would get educated, but the jobs and the opportunities for advancement were in the cities. So as kids graduate, they leave. And so there's a brain drain, and it negatively impacts a community. So you have those three things, to me, are really critical as to why many communities like Capulin in the western part of the United States have gone from very productive, lively communities to communities that are like this today. They're in decline. There's no economy to improve buildings or to draw people to the area. And some people still hang on simply because of their roots. Families stay, and some kids stay because the parents trust them to stay and still continue working what little land there is, or to just maintain ownership of property. So you see families here, but they all travel to Alamosa or somewhere to work and then come back in the evening. In the sense of community, as far as being a very lively community, has changed. But I think the sense of community is what still allows this community to be here, because people don't lose that sense of community. The best example is this church, is that in many places churches have gone into decline, but the people here still maintain the church because that's the root of the community. And they have great pride in that church. And so they'll give their last penny to the church just to make sure that it continues to be maintained and upkept in a way that they could continue to be proud of it.
What are your childhood memories of, you mentioned young kids that will grow up and get a good education and then, you know, go look for work or have to work, look for work elsewhere. What were your childhood memories of growing up and going to school? And
My childhood memories of this community were, my parents were very proud to be from this town, and they passed that pride on to us. And so for me, growing up here was, to me, I couldn't ask for a better place, because one, I felt I had received a very good education because of the nuns. Two, I felt a very deep sense of spirituality because of all the families being involved in the church, and the church being such a big part of the community. And the third part was that we did not realize we were living in poverty. For us, we were all wealthy. Wealthy in the sense of everybody knew each other, everybody supported each other, even though there were struggles and fights and those kinds of things, but they were always forgotten. Just like within a family, the family still comes together, and that's how I feel about this community. It still comes together, even though there may be struggles. They find ways of staying together as a community. Some other memories was that there was focus on youth. I mentioned the recreation center here, like the boxing gym and all that stuff, that there was a place for kids. Even earlier, before my time, my dad talked about being part of a baseball team that would travel around competing against other communities, to the point where my dad was good enough to play in a semi-pro team, a baseball team. And then the school, to me, the school was very much a sense of pride, because it's where we all gathered, we all got our education, we were very supportive of each other. And without that education, I don't think that many of us would have been able to prosper, given the conditions about the economics of the community.
What did your parents do when you were growing up to make a living?
My grandfather was a carpenter, and he also owned a gas station here in town. And when we go by there later, I'll point out in time. So those are the memories that I had, was a feeling like it was an honor and a treasure to be raised in this town, rather than thinking, oh, it's such a poor, ugly town. None of us ever thought of it that way. It was just a very lively town, I mean, especially when the school was very active. And that was another story that was tragic, in that this school district, Kapolei School District number 13, went as far west as the continental divide. And so that included the Platoro mines. And the mines were very productive at the time. And so a lot of tax revenue was generated from the mine that eventually ended up with the school. The La Jara School District and then Romeo and Manassa were farming communities. And so that really depended on Mother Nature. If you have a good year of production, you have good taxes, and you've got money to do things with. If it's a dry spell or a series of dry years, crops don't produce, farmers don't pay taxes, then the school districts don't have money. And so it was during that time period in the early 60s, late 50s, early 60s, that that took place. And so to make better use of the money, the school districts of La Jara, Romeo, and Manassa consolidated to form the North Connell School District. But they still didn't have a lot of money to operate. They built the Centauri High School in 1965. Still didn't have a lot of revenue because of the farm situations. And they saw the neighbor school district, Capulin, which is a small, small school district, had tons of money. So they applied, and because many of the legislators were from that area and were Anglo, they petitioned the state to consolidate the schools. So the Department of Education, through a move of consolidation, forced this district to consolidate with North Conejos. And they almost did that with Sanford, but the people in Sanford chose to tax themselves highly to maintain their school district. And to this day, my father was on the school board at the time this consolidation was taking place. He took many trips to Denver to go argue why they should remain separate, but it was legislative bodies that made the decision. And so this community, being Hispanic, didn't have anyone to speak for them.
How does a school district being consolidated change the future of a town like Capulin?
Well, obviously, with the school, there's employment and there's activity. There would be sports being played, whether it's baseball, basketball, football, those kinds of things. Back then, there were no girls sports, late 60s, 50s and 60s. But that created a sense of livelihood because of the school. Once the school was consolidated and all the kids were bused to Centauri, North Conejos, it had a huge impact on the community. The sense of a loss. It's like losing a member of a family. And so key things to any community are the church, the schools, and the businesses. And if one goes down, little by little, they all go down. And you can see that stores are closed, schools closed. The church survives because of people focusing their resources to the church. So, yeah, negative impact upon negative impact.
So you decided to leave. When was that initially? Was that to go to college? Was that?
That was when I left to go to college. And after I graduated, well, before I graduated, I had planned on going somewhere else and finding a job. I graduated, and before I graduated from Adams State, the school district in Alamosa offered me a contract to be a teacher in the district. So I actually signed a contract to become an employee of Alamosa School District in April, and I graduated from Adams State with my bachelor's in May. So that's why I stayed in the area. But then, as I stayed in the area, I also traveled to other places, kind of exploring what options there were. But even as I was in other places, what drew me back was the roots. My roots, my culture, my language, my history, and the beauty, the mountains so close by. And all the resources that mountains have to offer. That's what kept me here.